This is Duke University.
There is a lot. My history is just, it just goes way back to 1980. My first environmental research topic was at Oberlin with Professor Fuchsman for Winter Term Project. So you know what I'm talking about, on a consumer chemistry. So I know everyone is really concerned, and there's been a lot of discussion about the Flint, Michigan case. And to me, Flint, Michigan, there's nothing new about Flint, Michigan, based on my own experience as an engineer and a historian and an environmental epidemiologist. And if you see that headline, Flint water is safe to drink. Now, one of the things that I did do in the course of my career is I started off, just to give you a little history, I started off in the power industry as an environmental chemist, boots on the ground, seeing how water was treated to be in compliance with the Clean Water Act. And I also was an environmental systems and control engineer, and so I actually had to design my engineering systems to treat that water. There are a number of different pathways in which you have to treat water to meet the requirements of the Clean Water Act and the Safe Water Drinking Act. Most of those regulations, of course, were violated in the Flint water case. And the reason why it's called resilient resources is because there are basic resources that all living creatures need to survive on this planet. Clean air, clean water, sustainable soil. And once you start disrupting that with different types of toxicants, it is no longer sustainable for living organisms, and including, as we now see, human beings. So, for the scientists, for the policymakers, for the elected officials in the state of Michigan to declare that Flint in April 25th was safe drinking water is actually a hideous evolution in terms of environmental history, environmental justice history, because now we now know that children were poisoned. But let me just say one other thing. It wasn't only the children who were drinking the water, it was also the parents who were drinking the water. And I'll get a little bit more into that, especially for pregnant women. This becomes an insidious situation. Now, how many of you guys know about the history of the environmental justice movement? Just raise your hand. Sort of like a little shaking it. Okay, so as an environmental historian, we teach environmental history, we always talk about Rachel Carson, 1962, publication of Silent Spring. But there were a number of things happening in U.S. history and world history that we understood in the 20th century with our rise of technological development. We were producing chemicals, we were producing technologies that had effluents, that had outcomes that changed our air and our water and our soil. When we had Earth Day 1970, the image that a lot of people are given is that with Silent Spring and no more little birdie singing, that we had to have this sea change, we had to have this shift in our policies to protect our resources. One of the things that I write about is a chapter called Ball of Confusion in Natural Protest by Michael Egan. I wrote this chapter for him because I wanted to drill down and see what was the African American response to the first Earth Day in 1970. Now, I'm here because I grew up in Ohio. And in Ohio, I remember, given my age, the first Earth Day movement. And what I elucidated, what I demonstrated in that book through archival research, was that African Americans very much had an environmental concern in 1970. They had an environmental concern in 1950. They had an environmental concern in 1915, and they had an environmental concern in 1800, but it all revolved around public health. So when you see the Earth Day movement, 1970, you see elected leaders like Carl B. Soak saying, we're not gonna get out and support the first Earth Day, because guess what? We have a lack of sewage infrastructure. we have communities that have flooding. We have communities that have streets running with raw sewage in the northern states. In Chicago on Earth Day 1970, they were reporting cases of hepatitis because there was raw sewage with fecal matter flooding it. So the whole environmental justice movement emerged in response to what they felt lack of attention to the humans in the equation for environmental exposure. And so you have a number of different studies that were done by the United Church of Christ. And what I want to show you is that unequal protection. This is what environmental justice is supposed to be about. Unequal protection. Did you know that the environmental regulations of the United States were not really formulated to protect ecosystems? How many of you guys knew that? Environmental protections, thank you. Environmental protections actually came out of public health, right? The Clean Air Act was not meant to save owls. The Clean Air Act was meant to save or reduce the amount of exposures to human beings. And the same thing for the Safe Water Drinking Act. But with the environmental justice movement, we saw that African-American communities, communities of color, and poor communities were not getting that equal protection. So that is what that particular slide is about. And they will expect, now this was published at the 25th anniversary of the first study of UCC. You can expect different responses from the government when it comes to remediation, and now they're referring to Katrina. But the different responses also applies to Flint, Michigan. Unfortunately, 2016, the Great Migration period in the North occurred at the beginning. Actually, there was several migration periods, but let's stick with the one that most people are familiar with, the 1916. So 100 years later, we have white versus color. And we're talking about the toxic poisoning of an American city. African Americans migrated north for better opportunities, for better resources. Economic and environmental. But now we're looking at a situation with African Americans in the North with the franchise, able to elect their own leaders, but now their resources, basic resources, have not been protected, and in this case, through water. I wanted to give you this because this gives you the racial disparities across 10 US EPA regions. We're talking about Flint, so I wanted to just focus on region 5, which is what Flint is part of, Ohio, Indiana, Michigan. And here, the disparities in that region for people of color is 53% versus 19%. I only want to show this to you is because when we talk about environmental injustice, it crosses all regions. It is not peculiar to just the South or the Southwest or the Southeast. Environmental injustice crosses all 10 regions. Pollution, this is the most insidious part. When we do not protect the least of our communities, whether it's socioeconomic or racial, we expose ourselves to it. So it's not about white privilege. In fact, you should be scared. you should be scared. Because once lead enters into the water, water flows downhill. It permeates. If you know your water cycle, it evaporates. Once we have power plants and we allow power plants, coal-fired power plants to go unchecked and not comply with the regulations on clean air, that pollution does not stay within a 30-mile geographic radius of that power plant. There is no such thing as privilege protecting you against pollution. If I say anything else to you, understand that. If I allow PCBs to enter into my environment, that PCBs, if it's dumped, and not contained, according to what we know as engineers they should be contained. If it gets into your aquifers, it is throughout your environment. Everyone is going to be impacted by that. And so here is just basic percentages, and I'll leave the slides for you guys. Okay, you have 35 states that have economic, socioeconomic disparities. What you see, whether I was working for the power industry or as an environmental justice commissioner, is that the people with the least amount of power are the ones who suffer the most because they do not have a voice. They do not have a political voice. They do not have a social voice. They're not writing the articles. They're trying to survive. That is still unethical. And again, to the point that I just made, and even though they do not have a voice, the very fact that their environment is being polluted means that those waste streams are coming into the environment and coming to you soon. Let's get to the environmental epidemiology of lead. Let me just back this up and say before I get into that discussion. A couple weeks ago, as an environmental justice commissioner for the state of Illinois, we had the privilege of listening to the US EPA Region 5 representatives and saying, why? How could Flint, Michigan occur in 2016? How could a manager who was not an elected official make a decision on water resources for that community that would lead to this? And so the head of their water division said to us, well, he actually allowed four different decisions to be made scientifically. Each one put water quality at risk. Each one. So I said, well, if one would increase the lead content delivered to the consumer, how could he do two? How could he do three? Here's the EPA, who's supposed to be monitoring these companies, these municipalities. He says it was a mistake. That's mind-boggling to me as an engineer. I'm really serious. That's like, what? I was like, if I don't treat my water one way, that's one decision. But then I'm gonna not treat it and then not do something else. And just an overlay of several decisions. And all he could say in the call was, it was just a bad call. When I was a consultant, I was hired by Jones Day on lead to represent the lead industries of America. That was in 2006. It was a four-year study with four PhDs at my side on lead. What I will say about that study was that we knew when we turned in our report that this cognition of what lead does to the human body had been around for over 60 years. What lead does, and this is what this is showing to you, what lead does to the body has been known. Hearing problems, anemia, hypertension, muscle weakness. Look at the different levels of lead in Detroit versus Flint, Michigan, 2.3 to 27. This is 60 years after what we know happens to lead. This is what, I used to go to environmental history conferences and some of my colleagues would say, it's a benefit cost analysis. What is a benefit cost analysis? Some people have to bear the costs of our production. Some people have to bear the costs of human advancement. This is unacceptable. Because when you understand the environmental epidemiology of it, this is not just a nuisance for a day. This is a destruction of a human body for a lifetime. So, I wanted to introduce this. I also, when we were talking, I went to the COP21 in Paris back in December. Very, for me, watershed event because we actually were able to talk about the human costs of climate change. So when we talk about protecting the earth and the land, guess what? We needed to protect the unborn. And you know what? All the babies that were conceived in Flint, Michigan for the last 2 years who were exposed to lead were not protected. The neurological damage done to them cannot be undone. That is environmental justice in its worst form. The human body is part of the ecosystem. You are not separated from it. You are not separated from it. And so we cannot have city managers and public policy makers making decisions on our resources in air, water, and land that will change us, change our children, and in terms of environmental genomics, change them for generations to come through genetic mutation. So here's just the statistics of the percentage and cost of pediatric disease attributed to environmental pollution. Lead poisoning, very high. More so than asthma and neurological disorders. So, prior to Flint, we always thought about lead in terms of lead coming into the environment, to the human environment, through lead paint. And the existence of lead exposures from older housing because of lead paint. Now, when I did my research for the National Science Foundation, Engineering Infrastructures and Environmental Justice, we understood in 2006 that we were also looking at lead exposures through our water. And that is what Flint has done. Flint has made it very clear now that it's not just older housing, but it's also the water resources that come into those families. And in another recent discussion that I had, even when Flint tried to change back into methods of treatment and sources of water that was not lead laden, some of the decisions that they had made was causing the leaching of lead from older pipes, which had not been replaced. That is still a risk across the United States. All of your older geographies that laid that pipe 50, 60, 100 years ago are going to deal with this. Even in Chicago, without changing the treatment system, they still are finding high levels of lead to older homes with that older piping. The individuals responsible for changing that pipe is not the city. It's the homeowners. And in older cities, in older communities, this is where your poor are concentrated. These are the communities where people are renting. And the landlords have done a benefit cost analysis so that they're not going to get a return on their investment if they change that pipe. Unless there is a social and political movement from that community to say you are killing us, harming us, long term and for generations. So lead is not just from paint, and we all know that now. But here's it. So just think about that. In these older communities, now they're dealing with the reality of lead paint, which has not been remediated, and now psychologically dealing with the fact that even the water that's coming into their homes, in addition to the paint, is also contaminated with lead. So this is just the impact of lead. This was just based on the lead housing. There's 24 million homes in the United States which is deteriorated lead paint. I mean, I don't even know what to say at this point. They've been struggling with lead paint in housing for 50 years. And nothing has been done about it. It's only when we have these major catastrophes, we hit the news, that it's brought back to our attention, but then nothing else is done about it. So what happens after Flint is no longer in the news? And I just want to give you just a nice summary of what lead does to children versus lead does to an adult. Learning disabilities, hearing loss, low IQ, lack of motor skills. One of the things they don't have in here was a study that has been done that ties lead exposures to 30% of all violent crime in the inner city. So environmental justice is not just about, in this situation, as I perceive it as a scholar, as a writer, it is not just about having things located in your neighborhood, having landfills located in your neighborhood. Noxious, toxic, yes. I am deeply concerned as an environmental scholar about the actual changes to the human brain that is generational, that impacts the community. So here we're looking at low IQ, we're looking at violence. What will Flint, Michigan look like in 30 years? Even with pipes removed and replaced. How can we talk about equity and equal access to education and equal access to jobs? How can we talk about moving up the socioeconomic ladder when we have poisoned people from conception? What is the ethical ramification of that? What are you called to do about that? No amount of papers, no amount of books is going to change that reality. Can we really afford to grieve, to be angry in the moment without making some kind of structural and institutional change within our systems so that we learn and that we put force on our policymakers and our elected leaders to never have American children crippled from conception? That's just lead. I'm not even talking about polychlorinated biphenyls and everything else that we throw into the environment, and mercury, which I will get to in a minute. The degree of progress is measured about our ability to protect the very least of it. This country, if 33 or 30% of violent crime is tied to lead, that impacts everybody going in and out the city. That impacts so many different people. Do you think they're just going to stay in the city where they were born? They're not. Will it impact our workforce? It will. Now, I wanted to talk about mercury today because I have this is always something that bothers me. When people think about power plants, like in Illinois, one of our EJ activists is known for shutting down, or like being active in helping shut down 3 unregulated coal fire plants. And so they always show, you know, asthma tied to coal fire production. But mercury comes from coal fire production and fossil fuel production. Mercury, its greatest source is from power plants run on coal fire resources. And it's mercury that comes out the stack and it is dissolved into water in the form of methylmercury. Look how small it takes to contaminate just a small acre, 20-acre lake. That little amount of mercury, which is also tied to neurological development in children. It's tied to autism. So one of the things that I have done volunteer-wise is that I'm volunteering as a resilient resources doula. Because I'm deeply concerned about women who are pregnant in these environments. And when women go through training to have a baby and getting resources, they tell them all kinds of things, but they don't tell them about the water that they drink, how it impacts their fetal development. And so I really think, I've been talking about this for years, but I went to a Lamaze training at University of Chicago, PhD nurse, and she was giving this like overview of the things that women should not eat. And so she got to the fish and she talked about different types of tuna. And then she says, well, mackerel. She's like, I never heard of mackerel. Now I'm African American, Southern roots. I grew up on croquettes, I'm sorry. So my mother would make salmon croquettes and jack mackerel. She used it. But here's a nurse who's a PhD who's talking to these families from Chicago, at least half were African American. She's like, I don't know what that means. And I said, that's a major source of food. I grew up, my father was from Alabama. Catherine Coleman is my cousin. Both of my parents are from Alabama. So my dad went fishing when he went up, they migrated north, he went fishing every week, he went hunting, you know. And so, but most of our resources, our protein was fish, mercury contaminated fish. And it's not just Native Americans who eat fish. Even though that's, you know, the school of public health is like, oh, we're gonna help the Native American population. I said, no, you need to help some Southern people, black and white who eat fish, sorry. Because we ate fish. Look at that. This is in our water, right? People who eat fish are exposed to mercury poisoning. And this is what it's tied to, ADHD and autism. Okay. And this is the mean mercury levels, Hispanic versus black, in the United States, and you can see how high it is. Mexican Americans and non-Hispanic blacks, we have very high levels of mercury in our bloodstreams. This is what I mean by resilient resources. We have mercury, we have lead. I said I was only gonna talk 45 minutes. I mean, I'm not gonna even add the other ones in here. Just mercury and lead for today. So, I'm an environmental justice scholar. I'm a climate justice scholar. And I embrace all environmentalists. But if you want to save, you can go and save different species, you should do that. But you should care as much about human children as you do animals. You should care about the ecosystems of human beings. Save baby humans. And I'm referring to all the children of Flint for this day. And that would be for any child exposed to mercury, any child exposed to PCBs, any child exposed to fracking, any child exposed to radioactive materials in a polluted environment. When I taught 10 years ago, I used to teach science and non-science majors. And I used to tell my students, give them films on downwinders out west and how their environment was destroyed with nuclear testing. Save those baby humans. 10 miles from my house in Chicago, in the western suburbs of Chicago, I live near the largest number of Superfund sites in Illinois, Kerr-McGee Superfund site. The homes there cost about $1 million. Kerr-McGee in Illinois was one of the few places west, okay, that was mining radioactive material, first for clocks. So we started having high cancer rates, brain cancer rates, lung cancer rates. When they remediated the site by law, they sold the homes to low income and working class Hispanics who did not know the area, who were trying to get out the cities. We're about 40 miles out. And so now those communities these beautiful homes. It looks so bucolic, green, and they think they're moving up. But that particular city made an agreement with the real estate agents to not disclose that this was a former Superfund site. And so now they're getting bone cancer and brain cancer. And their children are suffering, and they don't know why until they start drilling down. And even though these non-disclosure agreements have been struck down through many cases in the United States with these Superfund remediation sites, it continues. And children suffer. This is why this was called resilient resources, sustainable. You cannot corrupt the environment without impacting every living organism, including human beings. You cannot think that just one part of the country is suffering from this injustice, because it is everywhere. And so our goal now is to educate ourselves, to have curriculums that emerge within institutions, that educate our students and make them understand the relationship between pollution, to get it out of the political discussion and into the scientific discussion and the philosophical and ethical ramifications. This is what higher institutions of learning should be doing. I'm a resilient doula because guess what? If you gentrify, we saw this in Chicago, in New York, if you gentrify an urban community, and you have money and education, all of a sudden you just want to live closer to the major city, like Chicago, New York. We found young professional couples with kids with ADD and ADHD, with lower IQ, that had never had that history in their family. Because guess what? They were renovating and no one was telling them about lead. They're moving in to older housing, brown, beautiful brownstones with lead pipes. There is no such thing as certain parts of society carrying the cost of progression, because people are moving back and they're changing their geographic spaces, and these spaces have not been remediated and not been brought into compliance, even though we have almost 50 to 60, sometimes 100 years of knowledge of what these pollutants can do to the human body. I want to talk about Zika, because I am a climate justice activist as well. We knew in the 2000s that with the changes in climate, that certain parts of the world would receive more water and certain areas would receive less. But Zika is a climate change disease. We knew that the vector-borne diseases would increase in frequency. And here we go with Zika. And so I'm sure you guys by now have known about the microcephaly, encephalitis with this exposure, but there's also a lot of debate within that discussion, which is going to take a lot of teasing out, whether it's the vector-borne disease or if it's the treatment of the mosquito population. Regardless, the outcome is because there's a change in the amount of water in the geography with these mosquito-borne diseases. And so they had 20 times more microcephaly in Brazil in 2015 than they had before. And so we knew this was coming. So the question here, let me stop at this point. There's, in a way, a relationship, because they're not separate, between environmental justice and climate justice. Environmental justice was saying certain individuals, certain populations would bear the brunt of our technological production. But guess what we found out in climate change? The whole globe bore the cost of technological advancement. The entire globe. Now, those who have the resources, right, will be able to move further and further and further away from these areas which will be impacted by climate change. So those who have money will be able to move forward. But if you're in Brazil, if you're visiting, you're living there, and we now have over 100 cases now in the United States of Zika exposure, then again, it's colorblind. It doesn't care who you are. You're in the wrong place at the wrong time, and the whole climate is being impacted by our technological advancements. So in this one, we showed Brazil and Bolivia, but now it's in the southern parts of the United States. So climate change, climate justice, environmental justice is justice for all of us. And I want to end on my discussion of climate change. So the same areas where we have lead housing and the same areas where we have lead pipes, those are the same areas which will have a higher death rate from climate change because, again, of the aging infrastructure, the older housing without air conditioning, without windows, heat island effect, as you know, the asphalt jungles, which will have increases in temperature, that will increase the ambient temperature to make it much more damaging and insidious in these older parts of the cities, these darker, older, decaying parts of the city. And then, like in Chicago, you'll have over 700 deaths when you do have a heat wave that were concentrated in these urban environments. The reason why climate change is also sort of like colorblind in another sense is that those individuals with those particular types of diseases, cardiovascular diseases, respiratory diseases, they will be at a higher environmental health risk. Their bodies cannot take the changes, rapid changes in temperature. So if you're diabetic, you're going to have a higher chance of having a heat stroke than someone who is non-diabetic. And I don't want to get into statistics of who have diabetes because it's changing, but heat change and climate change also creates these disparities in health tied to our changes in the environment. And my neighborhood is killing me. That's what we're dealing with. People inherit the environmental conditions, the poor people. But as we see in Illinois, we have people who are dying from heat waves in the more affluent areas because of changes in diet, because of the higher levels of diabetes now that we've never seen before. Their bodies are at risk as well. So it's not always necessarily your neighborhood that will be killing you. Those are just images of the heat wave in Chicago. You don't have to be Catholic to understand what he's saying. The warming caused by the enormous consumption of some rich countries. Our consumption is due to our industrial production. Our industrial production was carbon-based in fossil fuels, which caused heat change and which caused the pollutants now in the water, air, and land. Those are just some of the symptoms associated with heat exhaustion. And I'm going to end with that slide. And that's what we have to. Never argue with stupid people. There are a lot of people who deny a lot of things based out of ignorance and emotion. And so I stand here before you having worked for the power industry, having written white papers for the Electric Power Research Institute for 10 years. I work for the federal government. I did deep engineering analysis, statistical analysis. I've worked in environmental justice communities, gathering data for them. I think I'm a sort of balance between the two. And all I can say here in this discussion is the science is the science is the science. The outcomes are what they are. The National Institute of Health, the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences have dozens and hundreds and thousands of papers to show this connection between changing the human genome in its exposure to pollutants. No one's making that up. And I won't argue with somebody who's uninformed because it just doesn't sound right to them. And my prayer, literally, is that academia and other institutions really go after this mission of educating all of their students. You should not have to be a science major to know this when you graduate from college. Actually, it was up to me. Environmental education would be in the school systems K through 12. You shouldn't even have to go to college to get this information. And I have spent many years teaching MDs who go through medical school who do not know the connection between environmental exposure as part of their curriculum and human health. Every person on this planet now should understand the basic relationship between technology, technological outcomes in terms of pollutants, and its direct relationship to human health. So they can determine whether they're going to live next door to a landfill and not be argued down because it's just aesthetically unpleasing. To have enough concern to know that if you're living near a landfill, did it have a liner when it was created? Otherwise, you have your water systems that are being poisoned by the material in the landfill. And in Wayne, Illinois, in Chicago, outside of Chicago, with $2 million horsey farms, they were being poisoned by vinyl chloride because they were downhill from a landfill that was created without a liner. So the basic human being who's buying property should be aware of their environment. And then I'll end on that note.
And I'm intrigued by your plea to bring some of these issues out of politics and into the scholarly community. Because I teach political science here at the Nicholas School, and I'm always meeting with the students to bring science into the political community.
Yes.
And I'm hearing you have a lot of faith in if people have enough knowledge, they'll make the right decisions and they'll avoid these environmental risks.
So the executive order by Clinton, 1982, for environmental justice, you know that never moved forward. There was a pollution prevention program that was started by the US EPA that was shut down. I think the only reason why you had anything happening in Flint, Michigan was because the community was suffering and understood viscerally what was happening to their bodies. Environmental equity, environmental health protection cannot afford trickle-down politics. So that is here. I hope that answers your question. You have to know what is happening to your body. You have to be aware of that because politicians do not always do what is right. And in America, we have politicians who have people pay for their campaigns and they do not answer to the public.
You were standing in a state with the state legislature that legislated against the scientific evidence for global warming. No policies in North Carolina can be based on the evidence that says that the seas will rise. We are racing to the bottom to be more retrograde than South Carolina, Alabama, or Mississippi.
I feel bad for you. I'm sorry. I feel bad for you.
This was accomplished by a kind of gerrymandering that has got us sort of locked into a conservative legislature, but they did it, the newspaper reported it, people laughed about it, and we're hoping to, you know, change the legislature, but it's an instance in which...
I don't think these politics are going to happen overnight, but I do believe that an informed public, I presented at a public hearing in Chicago, Human Rights Commission, and they announced it, and we talk about public hearings, and there were very few people who showed up, And of the people who showed up, very few had a handle on the enough science to actually engage the commission. What's the point of having a public hearing if you cannot even be engaged in the conversation? If your public understood, if they truly understood what climate change was from a, you know, I don't want to say scientific, but just basic facts, just engaging them, tiny, all the way up. It may not happen tomorrow, but they would start rejecting idiocracy. And right now, to be fair to the public, they don't know. Most people do not understand most of this. They'll see this like, oh my gosh, some people will be overwhelmed. You know, how much of that is true? They would say, how much of that is true? And I could give them a whole list of things. The way the papers and everything that are written, they're written for scholars and academics. How much translation of this information, which they've been gathering and paying millions of dollars for, how much of that is communicated to the public? And if you're communicating to a public that doesn't even have the basics to read it and understand, what are we talking about? We're talking about a hegemony of those who know and can move away and protect themselves versus a whole lot of folks who have no idea what's going on and just think those are a bunch of eggheads in ivory towers.
You say that trickle-down politics is an effective way to approach these types of issues, but in cases of constrained agency where low-income communities are given the option and understand the implications of having a locally undesirable land use in their communities, when they're given that decision to have that potentially positive source of economic activity in their community, occasionally, like, people with no other option can choose to have a land dumping or waste site in their community because of the jobs that it would bring to the community. So how, like, have you seen any effective policy interventions that would allow for, that would protect people from falling into the path of choosing incorrectly, but for economic reasons?
I have seen situations where a person explains to the community, if you bring that here, yes, you will have jobs, but you'll also have high levels of asthma and your children be in the hospitals and they cannot function. Very few people choose the destruction of their children's lives over a job. And it's not, and it no longer becomes, you have more jobs here. It's like, they'll bring you jobs, but you'll have more death, and you have more illness, and your children will not be able to perform in the next generation. When you sit down and explain to them what the outcome of that is, they choose life. They choose life for their children over that extra dollar. Most human beings would. But very few people will go into that community and tell them exactly what that company produces and exactly what they're exposed to in that production. So you have to have that, you have to compare apples to apples. You have to talk about the actual cost. It's not nuisance anymore. It's actual changes in their health, long-term and generation. Nobody chooses a poison over their child's health. Not that I've been exposed to in 20 years.
And studies that have shown a link between mercury exposure and autism, but there was a falsified study that implied that that mercury exposure was from vaccines, and mm-hmm. that was an argument used in an anti-vaccination movement that was later shown to be fudge. But I think that pervasiveness of misinformation is still you know, making people think that they are educated when in fact they're miseducated. And I just wonder if you could speak to that.
Because, you know, I mean, this is where you have misinformation and people's like, I got it on Wikipedia, I Googled. I mean, there's so much out there now that people don't feel that they have to go to an authority. They don't have to go to a school and learn it. There's this communication problem that has emerged. And so, again, you're not gonna get rid of that overnight. But I think that if you have an institutionalized process where people are given basics, that they will be able to better discern the information that they are bombarded with on the internet and other resources. That's what I think. You need to have a base from which to work and not assume that everything on the internet is true. I think you need to have, like, this is what we understand to be the science, the true science, and make them learn it.
The education programs you're talking about will take a very long time, and we'll have sort of, you know, we're not sure we'll be successful to the extent we need it to be to eliminate these bads. What do you think can bridge the gap in the meantime?
So the US EPA will tell you, like, all the regions have environmental education grants. And so those types of programs that are out there by the government to actually create community education are things that should be pursued and instituted. There are centers that rise up. There's a West, like the WEACT, the West Harlem Environmental Action Group. I know Catherine Coleman Flowers Acres, she's trying to educate her community. Those kind of community activists, hopefully they're gonna get money poured into their communities and get the grants and educate the public. But it's never going to have the force and power of an educational institution who buys into it. So, I mean, I'm just thinking about a lot of things that started with the environmental justice movement back in the 80s. And they've been able to do certain parts of the country, certain regions, but they really have not. It's like a drop in the bucket. What could have happened if we actually get the universities and academic institutions involved? So yes, you can do community groups, but I've seen in 20 years that has not achieved the real objective, which is mass education on a larger scale. Yes?
I have a question. In this solution, how can we separate, or can you not separate this from educational inequity, structural racism, prison incarceration? Like, how can you separate that? And if you can't, do you think that this problem of environmental injustice can be solved without solving those?
There's a reason why the environmental justice movement emerged in the 80s, and there's no, I actually want to be politically correct in what I say right now.
I just don't see how this problem's going to be solved without solving those other problems, which we see.
They're intertwined.
To be solved in general.
They're intertwined. But the problem is that, as I said, environmental pollution. So here's the thing. You can say environmental justice is environmental racism. I've written, actually, my book actually deconstructs that concept, environmental racism, because I started this presentation saying that once you release the pollution into the environment, it's colorblind. People didn't really change their nuclear policies until they understood that the nuclear testing was impacting everyone. And I think this is what's going to happen in this country, when you realize that that pollution is causing, well, they know it, increases in infertility, low IQ, high asthma rates across the board. It's almost as if everyone has to be impacted to be motivated to change it. It's not altruistic. If it was altruistic and people feeling bad about it, they would have made the changes 30 years ago when the movement started.
Communities of color, what are some solutions that are rooted in those types of values?
Restate your question. I'm trying to, because I'm saying the community groups that are fighting for environmental justice should get the grants and should get support.
Are there currently solutions that are focused on communities of color?
What do you mean? I'm trying to understand. There's, like, if you look at Robert Bullard, people have gotten grants. Beverly Wright has gotten millions of dollars from National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. Peggy Shepherd Week has gotten millions of dollars as an environmental justice institution to inform and educate people of color in New York City. The University of Michigan, they've gotten millions of funding to do research, but I don't see the communities changing and getting better. That's what I'm saying. So these groups have gotten millions of dollars from the government into their community groups, but they have not had a watershed moment where the whole community is lifted up with their community activism and their education.
Do you feel like those solutions are rooted in her question over here? Or I apologize, I didn't solve that question.
Yes.
Yes, I do. But I believe that the academy is part of that structural racism. Because the academy has also gotten millions of dollars to do the research and have not created these programs. There are so many dissertations on environmental health disparity. I mean, if you just go Google it, NIH and just NIH, as you go, this research has been ongoing. So we know about it. The science is there. But the programs, one university I was affiliated with, the guy was like, environmental injustice is too political. It's too, even though we knew that people were getting sick and people were, in some cases, dying, it is a scientific reality. It is a public health reality. But it was constructed in terms of being too politically hot to touch. And I do believe that in some of the articles in Flint, if that had been an upper middle class community that had those health outcomes, it would have stopped a long time ago. So I started talking about who bears the brunt of our decisions in a technological and industrialized world. And there are certain people who, if you read my monograph, Packing Them in Archaeology of Environmental Racism, there are certain people who are considered expendable in our society. That's how it is. And it changes over time. There are certain groups that always stay that way. But in my particular book, and I think I was mentioning it to you when I came in, when I talked about the reversal of the Chicago River, it was considered like the engineering feat in world history in 1900. But very few people understood, until I wrote that book and I had to dig into many archives, many legal cases in Chicago, that that was a form of environmental racism. Because what had happened in Chicago when they reversed the Chicago River was they had industrialized the packing house industry, and they were just putting out sewage from animals and human waste. And the river was originally flowing in to Lake Michigan, which is where all the white Anglo-Saxon Protestants lived, the captains of industry lived, and their children started dying from typhoid and cholera. And so this is the beginning of germ theory. And so they figure out all this waste had to be redirected away from where the rich folks live. Major engineering feat, 1900, late 1800s. And when they reversed the Chicago River, all that waste that was pumping into Lake Michigan actually made a river come to a standing still. Reversal of the Chicago West, the West Branch, the West Branch of the Chicago River. They had methane gas bubbles, 6 to 8 feet high by 12 feet wide. And when I present on that book, you actually see people walking through. There's pictures of men captured in a methane gas bubble. So guess what happened to all the Eastern Europeans who were not considered white? their children start dropping like flies. The Mississippi started getting higher levels of excrement being pushed down because now it was going to the Mississippi. And so the city of St. Louis sued the city of Chicago. They did. And Canada sued Chicago because by doing that reversal, the water tables in Canada dropped and changed their ecosystems. So we have always had this structural racism. But you know, over time, the Eastern Europeans moved out of the back of the yard. And you know who moved in, right? So who is exposed and who is not exposed? We've been doing this for a very, very long time. In countries where you think everybody looked alike, there's ethnic battles in Nigeria, and there are people who bear the cost there. They're all black. So it comes down to who has power, who does not have power. Who's living in the areas that we consider as dumping grounds and dumping people, who does not? It's only when everybody's in the same boat or everyone starts having impact on their bodies that we want to do something about it. Believe me, nobody's going to let coal-fired plants run unregulated in the United States because we know what it does to respiratory diseases. They will shut it down. You see what I'm saying? So this is what's happening to us. The ones who are poorest have to carry the brunt longer. Eventually, it spreads out. And we can hope that these community groups organize and get the money, but it's not sufficient for those groups. It has shown, the history of it is that they have not done enough to protect these communities. You need a bigger push by larger organizations who are invested in this concept, philosophically, scientifically, and ethically. That is what you need. And I say that as an environmental justice scholar for 20 years. These little community groups, even the big ones, are not making a sufficient dent. You still have problems in Katrina. You still have public health issues associated with Katrina. That is over 10 years, almost 10 years. With major EJ groups who have organized around it, and they still have not dealt with it.
In a lot of cases, what it comes down to is, you know, people don't have information. Mm-hmm. They don't understand how to process it. The way our system is structured, the onus is on them to get the information.
Yes.
So, like, I have a private well at my house. I know the water quality because I'm married to a hydrologist who can test my water. But other people don't know what's in their water. And so there are these, you know, constraints on, they don't have the resources, they don't have the education, they just don't know. Mm-hmm. And then also, you know, you talked about the realtors. They don't want public disclosure mm-hmm. because it lowers, you know, or even homeowners don't want to know what's in their well water at times because it may lower the price of their home.
Property values, yeah. Right.
And so, at the end of the day, who is ultimately responsible for, one, procuring that information, making it available, communicating, but then, as we know in the case of Alabama, it's so expensive to repair the sewage systems, mm-hmm. septic systems, that even if they have the information, they can't do anything, but the public institution government just says, well, it's your problem, and we'll fine you.
Well, that's what they're saying in Flint, and it's going to be in Chicago, that it's the homeowners who have to replace the lead piping that comes to their home.
So how do you get public institutions I find it almost, that tension where communities don't have the resources, even if they get the knowledge. So how do you shift it so there's better accountability on the part of, government and state, and it sometimes runs counter to the way
they can type in that information, but how do they then understand the information that comes out of that engine. This comes back to education, I'm telling you. So I used to have a class I would create for my students and I would type in your zip code, go to US EPA, go to these different environmental groups that were created private sometimes, and they would get it. So, but what does that mean? You see what I'm saying? So there is like the US EPA is like, we're here to protect the public, we have this information, we have GIS, how does that person understand that? How does the community group that has formed to be activists, what is their level of knowledge, even if they get the information and communicating that to the community, right? It's all come back to cognition and understanding of the basic concepts, which is why I said everyone should have a basic understanding of the environment, pollution, and human health. A basic understanding. So when I'm sitting here in the information age and typing in my zip code and looking up information articles about my neighborhood and reports about what happened, that I actually understand what I'm looking at and reading. You don't have that. And in terms of funding, I mean, go to Bill Gates, I used to be on the board of the Al Leopold Foundation, right? You don't have to go to the government, go to private funders. You know, there's so many different ways to do that. But if you go to a private funder, you better know what you're asking for. You better have enough education to know what you're asking for and what you're trying to do once you get the money, and to know how effective it will be in your drive, right? So you just can't say, okay, you can't just rely on the government. There's other resources. There's other ways of getting money. But you have to have education to advocate. You have to have a basic knowledge to advocate and ask for an education. When my journal sponsored a healthy housing conference papers for WEACT in the end of 2014, there was a discussion on mold in apartment. And there was a woman, I was like in shock, who was put on stage with her daughter and her granddaughter, and they had this mold situation in this one apartment for like 15 years. And there was respiratory issues. And I could hear the mumbling in the audience. It's like, well, if you knew this mold was causing problems for you and your daughter, why then are you on stage complaining about your grandbaby now, who's been exposed to mold in the same apartment? Yes, you can say that's environmental injustice, but someone, in my opinion, my humble opinion, once that woman understood what the relationship was to her immediate environment and to the health outcomes, someone should have been trying to get her into a healthy house, a healthy apartment, and not have three generations dealing with respiratory issues to a known agent. So it's not just enough to complain. And people are complaining and not understanding how to get to the next step because they don't fully grasp the connections between the environment. And I will say this much, these community groups have to be, who are engaged in this, have to be open with what they're doing, the money that's coming in, and what the outcomes will be. Do you understand what I said? So it's not enough to get millions and millions of dollars if you're a community activist. You have to show how that has helped the community, and the community has to move forward. I used to take my students in for EJIN tours in Illinois, and I don't want to get too much into details of that, but my students always come back to me and say, Dr. Washington, if they know that this pollution is there, why are they choosing to stay, especially if they had housing vouchers to move into cleaner environments? I don't think in certain parts of the community they fully grasp what was going on. We have to get people to understand. We can't have people just collecting money and not showing how it's taking people up and away from those environmental assaults on their bodies. Because there has been millions that have been put out there. But people don't know about them, they don't apply. Those who do get the money apply, and they, you know, there's just, it's too much to talk about here in terms of how do we get that out there. But I really think it comes down to people having a clear understanding between exposure and human health so that they can make a decision to move out. I know in Chicago there were vouchers that were used to move out of the community. And a lot of, one of some of the outcomes was that I don't feel comfortable moving away from this environment where we've been for generations. And so then you have to come back and say, but if that particular environment that you built generations of experience on are having these environmental impacts on your body and your children's bodies. And that was not happening because people didn't know that was one of the trade-offs of staying there. They don't know. Because we don't teach people that.
When you state education as the solution to this issue that we're talking about, how do you see it panning out in the face of corporations? Meaning, how does educating a large group of people on very pertinent issues affect directly corporations making decisions that harm specific groups or low-income communities directly?
A pure example where I live. I live in DuPage County outside of Chicago. And it's Republican territory. Seriously, it's like one of the most Republican territories in the United States. They are incredible environmentalists, Republican environmentalists. And they will shut down any factory, any business that come in and try to destroy their green space and put pollution in there. Because they understand, they're so active and so engaged. There's so many engineers and scientists who live there, and it's like, we know what this is. You're not gonna do it. And they are very active in mobilizing and shutting down major corporations' efforts to come and pollute in their neighborhoods. This is about education. This is about knowledge. This is about connecting the dots. This is like, they would say, oh, great, how many jobs you're bringing in? We will not have you, you know, waylay our trees and contaminate our water. This has been shown over again. Highly educated communities will make that decision to protect their bodies and their communities environmentally. Yes. So it doesn't matter. Corporations cannot overcome that community.
In those low-income areas where they are not yet educated, like you said, it's not going to happen overnight. How do you address those corporations, and how do you get that population to address the corporations?
I think what I have seen is that when you have university students and universities are approached and those community leaders go to those universities and ask for help and get them engaged, they then become the spokespeople for those communities. That's how it happens. The best thing that happened to inner city communities, although there's a lot of benefit costing on this, is gentrification. So you have young professionals whose children and whose bodies are at risk, and suddenly things are enforced by the city, by the state, that never were enforced before because they have the power and the voice and the connections to make those changes.
So you have education, the academy, engaging with community groups to hopefully press forward to help alleviate some of the injustice. But on the other side, you have the academy as a part of, and I very much recognize this, the system of structural racism and institutional racism. And there's tension there.
Yes.
And how does the academy successfully engage with communities, with the environmental justice community, without replicating this system of structural and institutional racism?
The academy has to be committed to employing people who are within the academy who are committed to that. If the academy does not employ people or create institutions within the academy to be a resource for the community, it will not happen. That's what happens. Universities that created divisions, departments, institutes that are well-funded can do that. Academies who don't cannot. They cannot respond to it. So that becomes a commitment of the academy to do that.
Produced by Duke University, online at duke.edu.